as promised earlier on, as we had told you in the beginning, our guest is finally here. And of course, we are thanking you so sincerely and dearly for keeping it 89.7 Contact FM. It's time for one-on-one with the Secretary General of the East African Community, Ambassador Richard Sezivera. Welcome to one-on-one.
Thank you very much.
It's been a long time coming.
I know. Thank you very much. And yes, I apologize for being a few minutes late.
Yes.
Kigali has developed since
a lot.
There's a bit of traffic.
Before you left for Tanzania, there was no traffic.
No, there was no jam. Now I was stuck a little bit in a jam, which is a good thing. It shows a lot of development.
In the country. Thank you so much for gracing the show. And of course, we are going to be looking deeply into some of the developments in the East African Community integration process. Plus, of course, any other news that we have to share with our public on this line. But we'll start, first of all, with where you come from or where you stay nowadays in your position. A lot has been said about this country, Tanzania, when it comes to the issues of integration. Maybe from a person who lives there and spends time with these people there, what's really the issue? Are we having a misconception about Tanzania's willingness to be in the East African Community or what?
Well, let me begin with some good news.
Yes.
Tanzania is the first country mm-hmm. in the East African Community to ratify the Monetary Union Protocol mm-hmm. and deposit those instruments of ratification with the Secretary General, mm-hmm. Which is, if any evidence were needed,
yes,
of the fact that that country is a member of the East African Community, I think this is good evidence. Mm. But Ken, these five countries all have different political systems. Mm. They have different bureaucracies. They have different capacities to implement projects and programs. Mm. And therefore, we do get some countries that are extremely fast in implementation of programs.
And others that are also extremely slow.
Rwanda is one of them. Uh-huh. Kenya is one of them. Uganda has now joined. Mm-hmm. And then in some other areas, Burundi might be slow for different reasons, mm. for lack of technical capacity or some other issues. So it depends. I think overall, the integration process is going very well.
Okay. So those who came up with this concocted word of coalition of the willing and the coalition of unwilling, do you feel these are just people who had malicious intentions of portraying the integration process as something that is probably headed for the doom in terms of the unity of all the five partner states?
Well, no, the coalition of the willing, I think, it's a headline concoction. Mm-hmm. Nobody has called themselves the coalition of the willing or the coalition of the unwilling. Mm-hmm. Let me tell you what happened. Mm-hmm. In 2004, mm-hmm. all the heads of state met in Nairobi to agree on fast-tracking the integration process for East Africa. 2004. Mm-hmm. And therefore, all the five partner states mm-hmm. have bought into this fast-tracking process. It's not that some should move faster and
others slower. Yes.
No, the decision was taken by the five, which is why we have a customs union from 2005. Before it is fully implemented, we agree on a common market, begin implementation. As we implement the common market, we negotiate a monetary union protocol. Once we begin starting implementation mm-hmm. of the monetary union protocol, we will, as the heads of state have decided, begin a process mm-hmm. of constitution making for the political federation of East Africa. Mm-hmm. So every phase of the integration process for the community mm-hmm. is being fast tracked.
Okay.
Now, some projects along the Northern Corridor, which is a very good thing, the Northern Corridor integration projects are East African community projects. Mm-hmm. They were agreed by all five
all of
partner
them.
States.
Yes, yes.
All of them. Mm. But the three countries are fast tracking those implementation, which is very good.
While two are slow tracking, can it be read in that aspect?
No, because we don't see
the same speed. As you say, it's not a decision by all of them to move, one moving fast and the other moving slowly. But the reality is we are not seeing the same speed by all the five member states.
But you will not see the same speed for a very simple reason. Some mm-hmm. of the some of the projects mm-hmm. cannot be implemented by the five partner states. Mm-hmm. Rail is an example.
Yes.
Railway from Mombasa to Kigali. Mm. By design, it has to be implemented by Kenya, Uganda, Rwanda and Burundi.
Mm.
So you will not see Tanzania there. The pipeline from Eldoret to Kampala, to Kigali, to Bujumbura,
mm.
that will be implemented by those countries.
Mm-hmm.
But on the Central Corridor, we also have the rail from Dar es Salaam to Kigali, eventually to Keza Msongati. It mm. is true
mm.
that has been a bit slow, but Tanzania, Rwanda, and Burundi have a secretariat to negotiate and talk about this project
mm.
oneself. So these coalitions around projects
mm.
are a normal phenomenon in our community. Mm. And we are beginning to see a lot of movement on the Central Corridor also. The Port of Dar es Salaam
mm.
has also reduced clearance times to no more than 10 days.
Mm.
They are working through a charter for the Port of Dar es Salaam.
To even reduce the days.
Even further.
Further.
The government of Tanzania is removing roadblocks. I think there were 35. They came down to 15. I'm told they now want to reduce them to 3.
Mm-hmm.
The way bridges are the same. So work is also ongoing on the Central Corridor. But I must commend
mm-hmm.
the speed, the impetus,
mm-hmm.
And the political will and commitment
mm-hmm.
That by the leaders who are spearheading the Northern Corridor integration projects,
mm.
because this has created a good new momentum
mm.
for all of us.
Because as you say, the reduction pace of even these roadblocks, as you clearly put it, maybe some member states or those who are doing business within this region would say, then this doesn't give us fair grounds for doing business. Why is it that us on our side, for example, in Rwanda or Kenya, for example, have removed all roadblocks or more roadblocks while others still have some roadblocks? For what reason would we even see a gradual removal of roadblocks? Why don't we see a complete removal of roadblocks?
Well, I can only agree with you. It doesn't make sense to have roadblocks. Those mm. that remove roadblocks...
Mm.
Grow their economies faster,
mm-hmm.
prices come down.
Mm-hmm.
And so roadblocks really do not add much. They yes. simply are an inconvenience.
Mm-hmm.
Now, let me tell you, though, that with the coming into force of the single customs territory,
mm-hmm.
where goods enter the community through and are cleared once
mm-hmm.
at the point of entry,
mm-hmm.
then the roadblocks even become redundant. If you couple that with the installation of electronic cargo tracking system,
yes,
so that people cannot offload goods in away from their destination,
mm.
then it makes life much easier. And I'm glad to say that all countries are now investing in electronic cargo tracking systems.
Mm-hmm.
They're beginning to work on the Central Corridor and on the Northern Corridor. So I think the single customs territory will move even those who were a bit reluctant to remove mm. roadblocks,
mm.
Will be forced to do so. And I'm glad that it is now being piloted
mm-hmm.
On the Central Corridor also.
Okay. Now, getting back to the issues of whether this dream of Jumuiya is a shared dream by all nations, because we've had a few people also on the ground who kind of feel out of touch, feel disconnected. They kind of feel that more focus has been put on the business angle, these big dreams of the railways, but the common people in terms of what exactly can they benefit from this, apart from just these big dreams that we're having. How then do we explain that element of inclusion of citizens in all this that we are talking about? Probably as a Secretary General, from your seat or from your office, what are some of the things that you see or think leaders need to do in order to bring on board their citizens so that they can also share in this big dream that we have?
Well, I think, first of all, Ken, I think the population of East Africa
mm.
have probably moved faster in integration than those who are in politics mm. or in the bureaucracies. I
mm.
think when you meet the women in business who are doing cross-border business, they want more integration, not less.
Mm-hmm.
When we talk to the students, and we do talk to the students,
mm-hmm.
they want more integration, not less. They want to be able to move and study where the opportunity is
mm-hmm.
and work where the opportunity is within East Africa.
Mm-hmm.
When we've just been having a meeting with all the religious leaders in East Africa,
yes.
The leaders are here in Kigali discussing issues of terrorism and how they can contribute to this fight. But they are also talking about integration, and they want deeper integration. Mm. So in many ways, I think the challenge is for the leaders to deliver on the promise of integration that the citizens demand and work.
Mm-hmm.
Now, there are some areas which are very technical, and of course, the people will not necessarily be involved. I mean, if you are doing monetary policy,
yes,
some of those issues are so technical that not everybody will be fully on board.
Why wouldn't they? Because it will affect them at the end of the day, right?
Yes, but if you are going to have a meeting about macroeconomic convergence criteria,
mm-hmm.
you can imagine that it would be very difficult to involve my mother in mm-hmm. that discussion.
But how do you?
What she wants,
yes,
is to see the result
of that
of that discussion.
Mm.
Yeah. So when the ministers of finance meet, and when the ministers of when the governors of central banks meet, and do the cooking in the kitchen,
mm.
and then citizens can buy and sell in East Africa using local currency
mm-hmm.
without the need for the dollar,
mm-hmm.
as is happening now,
mm-hmm.
then yes, that is citizen involvement.
All right. I'll be coming into the issue you've raised here, which is very important, and that is the issue of insecurity within the region. But before we go into the issue of insecurity, let's talk movement. Mostly when we have major meetings involving African leaders, we have heard, even from our own president here, that there is need to have a visa-less Africa, a borderless Africa, literally, where you can move freely without having to go through the big, enormous procedures of having a visa to travel within those regions. But before we even get to that bigger scale of talking Africa, I would expect that we should probably start looking at within our region, how best can we then make that a reality for others maybe to learn from our situation. But today as we speak, we still have no common ground on that issue of what to use as a paper or a document to move. We only have three countries that have decided to use the ID to simplify movement of some people who are looking for opportunities within the region. When are we going to see all the five member states fully come to the table and agree that this is what we want for our citizens?
No, well, actually, they have already agreed.
Mm-hmm. But when are we seeing
it? It was a decision that was taken that mm-hmm. People within East Africa
mm-hmm.
should use IDs
mm-hmm.
for national IDs for travel within East Africa,
mm-hmm.
And the four partner states agreed to start. Tanzania said they would come in later, and then
mm-hmm.
we have also agreed that we will have one new generation internationalized East African passport.
Mm-hmm.
This will be launched, is expected to be launched in 2015 by the heads of state.
Mm-hmm.
So the agreement is there. Now the challenge has been implementation. And I'll tell you why
mm-hmm.
What is happening, of course, on the Northern Corridor is exciting
mm-hmm.
about implementation.
Mm-hmm.
Implementation delayed partly because some countries have no national IDs.
Yes.
Republic of Uganda.
Uganda today. They are registering for that.
Yes.
Yeah.
Mm. Some of them had IDs that were not machine readable.
Mm-hmm.
And so they wanted to, Burundi is a case in point.
Mm-hmm.
So they wanted to first issue national identity cards that are machine readable. But now we have shown, I think the three countries have shown that you can use IDs.
The normal one.
That are not machine readable.
Mm.
You can use other documents, including voters' cards and so on. So this is a good thing. We have had for many years now something that people don't talk about,
mm.
student passes.
Mm-hmm.
If you're a student in East Africa and you're going to study within East Africa, you don't need a passport. You get a student pass.
Is this the laissez-passer?
Well, in French they call it a laissez-passer, but mm-hmm. but it's not the laissez-passer for mm-hmm. adults.
Mm-hmm.
It's a student,
for the
it's a special student pass.
Mm-hmm.
People around borders can move without documents. All they need is a clearance from their local authority.
Mm-hmm.
Women
as
and
well.
Men mm-hmm. doing mm-hmm. business mm-hmm. around the borders, if it's less than $500, we have simplified rules of origin certificates that you get at the borders.
Mm-hmm.
So there's been a lot of work that's been done
to streamline and ease the movement of people.
And this must continue. It's good. It's not enough. It must be intensified and continue.
Okay. You said earlier on that there are some countries, particularly like Tanzania, that said we will join later. Maybe without being diplomatic, do you feel or do you agree with these fears or these concerns that some of these countries that are not ready to jump into this plan, do you agree with their fears? Do you feel their genuine fears?
Well, it depends on what it is. Mm-hmm. That you're talking about.
What have they told you probably that Bwana SG, for us, we feel, or maybe to the secretariat, that they feel that they cannot be able to be part of this due to those reasons?
For example, for the national ID, Tanzania gave two major reasons. One was that they do not have an ID, so it's impossible for them to even know, even internally, to know who is a Tanzanian, because they don't register
the citizens
and give them national IDs. So they wanted to first do this, and they're doing so. They've begun issuing national IDs with difficulty, but they've begun. The second one was that they wanted to be to have a good agreement around the sharing of databases when people are moving around the region, and that requires investments in infrastructure, IT, which they said they have to make. So on that particular area, they had
those
were the reasons.
Which you feel are genuine.
I think they can be overcome. Mm-hmm. I think they can be overcome. But I understand them. Mm-hmm. I think one can still, with a bit of ingenuity, as has been shown on the Northern Corridor, deal with those two issues. But I fully understand that people can have those fears.
Okay. Let's talk about the security issues and insecurity issues within the region and what we've seen happening in Kenya. Just a few days ago, Kenya was marking the commemoration or the anniversary of the day that the Westgate Mall was attacked by the Al-Shabaab. A few days ago also, Uganda discovered, a cell where several terrorist ammunition and equipment were being kept. The region seems to be, prone to attacks, especially from the Al-Shabaab. So what do we do then as a region in terms of coming together and saying these are the common things that we can stand together to do to protect the nation or the region as EAC? We have the East African Standby Brigade. Should we expect a force that would probably come in and support in case of any problem like this? Because most of the time we've seen the Israelis, in most cases, coming in to support in these areas. But we haven't seen a special group or force or unit from the region even being instituted or coming in to support in these kind of cases. What do we do to show solidarity together and say we can protect ourselves as a region against these people?
Well, this region, fortunately, unlike maybe some other parts of Africa, this region has the capacity to protect itself and to protect the people from, be they genocidal forces as the FDLR are in Eastern Congo, be they Al-Shabaab that are causing terror in our region. That capacity is there. And there is a lot of coordination and cooperation. So at the East African community level, the ministers of defense have just agreed on a common counterterrorism strategy, which is now being put into operation. I cannot describe that strategy on radio,
okay,
but it exists. It is being put in operation. Our chiefs of defense are in constant contact. Our chiefs of intelligence, military, or civilian have a forum. They're also in constant contact. Our chiefs of police, correctional services, they have a forum. There is a counterterrorism center, which, as you know, is based in Nairobi. And all our partner states have officers manning that counterterrorism center to coordinate our actions on a daily basis,
as a region,
we are setting up a regional referral forensic laboratory for the police in Uganda to make sure that these investigations can be carried out forensic investigations carried out jointly.
But the sad picture, my friend, is that whenever any of these East African countries is under attack, there seems to be a sense of every country to deal with its own problem. I mean, we kind of, this is what comes on the face value, but not what you say, like we have the capacity to deal with these issues. But when we have an attack, what we see is a nation dealing with its problems as a nation individually.
Yeah, no, but well, first of all, that is true. Mm-hmm. But the reason for that is, as I said at the beginning, is that our countries have the capacity to deal with those problems.
Individually.
Yes. And when they run out of, when they need support, then they ask for the support. Mm-hmm. But as I said, a lot of the work of the coordination of cooperation in counterterrorism and these security issues, of course, takes place not in the limelight. Mm-hmm. What you have seen, and I think you mentioned it, foreigners that come in, Westgate was a perfect example.
Yes.
Of Kenya looking for capacities that were not within the region. Mm-hmm. And that's true. There are some capacities that we do not have.
And what are we doing about it?
We capacities built, yeah, but we're not yet there. Mm-hmm. So there are still some issues, and where those capacities are required, then countries look for those capacities from where they are.
Today as we speak, are you able to promise the listener listening to you with that particular thought in mind that, you know, whenever my country will be in trouble, my neighbor who is a member of this East African community region will stand by me, will be able to come in and protect me. Are we able to give them a timeline on this line that you're saying, these capacities being built to be able to offer this kind of support that would be closer than waiting for, you know, other people from other nations to board those planes to come to assist us?
It exists even now. Mm-hmm. The region agreed on a protocol. Mm-hmm. We have now a memorandum of understanding on defense. So our defense forces train together. They play together. Mm-hmm. They know each other. They share facilities. There are centers of excellence that they do share, which allows them, mm-hmm. within the East African Standby Brigade, mm-hmm. to actually have doctrines that are close to each other and to become interoperable. Mm-hmm. So that capacity already exists. Mm-hmm. We now have a protocol on defense, which was agreed by the heads of state. It's going to be... It's awaiting ratification. Mm-hmm. And within that provision, mm-hmm. There is a provision for a mutual defense pact, which...
So these are measures that have been taken recently after we have had these kind of problems, right?
There are measures that have been many years in the making, but are now coming to fruition.
To fruition now. Let's move a bit away from insecurity issues and talk about... issues on justice as well, because also judicial issues, there's always a need for probably a closer or a homegrown, when I say homegrown, I'm talking the regional, from a regional perspective. We have the issues of ICC, and we've had a lot talked about in terms of how the ICC cannot be able to, or should not be the one handling the Kenyan situations. But others who have been arguing and saying, then why can't we have a regional institution? What are our regional courts doing to be able to sort out such kind of issues that we face? If we say that the ICC cannot handle, then why can't we have the East African Court of Justice then handling such things? Because justice is needed at the end of the day.
You are right. I will agree with you on that. Mm-hmm. I think on issues of justice, yes. National institutions are best placed to handle them, actually.
Mm-hmm. But in the cases where they fail...
No,
someone has to be around.
I think we shouldn't jump to think that they'll fail. I mean, we've seen countries in our region handle very complicated cases. Mm-hmm. Rwanda is an example. Mm-hmm. No nation has had to deal with genocide and recover from it, mm-hmm. the way this country has. Mm-hmm. Uganda dealt with their own issues and their own history that was very complicated, mm-hmm. through national institutions. Mm-hmm. I am confident, and I know that Kenyan institutions can deal with the post-electoral violence of 2007. Mm-hmm. Now, Burundi is the same. They can set up national institutions that deal with issues of that history. Because in post-conflict countries like ours, mm-hmm. justice cannot be divorced from other imperatives, from national reconciliation, mm-hmm. from issues of national reconstruction, mm-hmm. from issues of reparations, mm-hmm. and so on and so forth. Mm-hmm. And no court, no external court in the world can deal with those issues. Mm. Now, when you can't, when you have no capacity or are overwhelmed, then the next best place to go is the region. I fully agree with you. Mm-hmm. That's where the East African Court of Justice should be empowered to deal with human rights issues. I do believe that.
Yes.
The heads of state took a decision that this should happen. Fortunately, the African Court of Justice now has jurisdiction over war crimes and crimes of
against humanity. So as we speak today, they are able to handle cases of that magnitude.
Yes, the decision was taken, mm-hmm. and we are working closely with the African Court of Justice because that is our regional court.
Mm-hmm. So what you're trying to say is also that those who feel that maybe, because again, I believe that the issues of putting things into context is important, because we can say that, yes, Rwanda dealt with its problems the way it did, other countries did the way they did, but always there's that context part where you find maybe local citizens in Kenya feel that the local courts may not be able to handle. But we feel maybe if we have an East African court, then it can be able to handle that. But when you say that this is in the pipeline, that the African court is also able to do this, then maybe this is good news for such people. But when, the point or the question is, when will they be able to do that? Will we wait again for another period until we have no options and start thinking of people like ICC?
But why would you think of people like ICC?
Mm.
I think we should be thinking about national solutions.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. If we get impatient
mm-hmm.
as Africans
mm-hmm.
with our region, we should be getting impatient with ourselves
mm-hmm.
and putting in place measures to take our own decisions.
Mm-hmm.
And I see absolutely no reason why Kenya cannot handle
mm-hmm.
those cases.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely none.
Okay.
Now, I also see no reason why Africa cannot handle these cases, or even our own East African Court of Justice, that is already handling a number of cases of a human rights nature, by the way, as we speak.
Mm.
They've found a way to interpret the treaty that allows them to handle some of these cases. But the point I'm trying to make is that these issues of post-conflict violence, post-conflict nation building, cannot be outsourced to the global community. We, as nations, have to take them on our shoulders and solve them,
mm.
because nobody can solve them for us.
All right. Very powerful indeed, Mao. Maybe in final, as we move towards the close of the discussion, I would like us to have a quick comment from your side. There's this latest development, this latest news that is going on, doing rounds in the media today in Juba. I understand Juba or South Sudan had applied to join the EAC, but we have developments going on in there. Like on Tuesday, we had news from different media reports that the country had decided to expel foreigners from the country in certain institutions. Today, we are hearing that the government is planning to reverse that decision. Maybe a quick reaction from you as a person or from an institution that has also seen its member states support South Sudan to get to where it is today. What comment would you make on such a decision?
Well, I have to say, I've only heard about it.
Mm-hmm.
I have not talked to the government of South Sudan, so I don't even know whether it's true or not.
Mm-hmm.
What I can say is that South Sudan has applied to join the community.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, the community has fundamental principles.
Mm-hmm.
First of all, respect for human life, human rights, and people's property is fundamental.
Mm-hmm.
In our treaty.
Mm-hmm.
So were this to be true, then they would be part of the menu for our negotiations with the Republic of South Sudan. Mm-hmm. Were it to be true. We have also had a number of discussions with the government of South Sudan. Both our governments have, and we ourselves have shared it, on some of the alleged abuses against traders in East Africa committed
working in
working in South Sudan. Mm. This list, when I was in Juba a few months ago, and we shared the list, and the president promised that he would solve it quickly. So these are issues that would be on the table for negotiations as South Sudan joins the community. Mm. But as you said, South Sudan is a historical neighbor. Our region is interested in stability of South Sudan, has participated in the struggle for liberation of the Republic of South Sudan. Mm-hmm. And I see absolutely no reason why this dialogue cannot continue to make sure that the South Sudanese surmount their problems and eventually join our community.
Okay. All right. So as we close, I'd like to ask you a very personal question, because it's been years now since you relocated to Tanzania. It would be easy or nice to understand or know some of the things that maybe have changed either in your social life, maybe after moving to Tanzania. What are some of those things that you'd like to share with us that you feel you've been able to adjust or change, that you're not getting there that you used to have here in Rwanda, or vice versa?
No, I can only say that Rwanda's progress continues to amaze. Mm-hmm. I mean, year in, year out, there is positive transformation. Mm-hmm. You are absent for 3 months, you come back, and there are new buildings, there are new processes, there are new procedures. Mm-hmm. Just the other day, I was here, because this is my home. I was home, mm-hmm. and then I went back, and I came back 3 months later. I couldn't recognize the airport. It was a completely different setup.
Yes.
So it's the transformation is phenomenal, and it makes you proud to be Rwandan.
Okay.
Yeah.
And when you're in Tanzania, what are your social activities when you're free, when you're out of the office, you've removed your tie, you say, now it's time to relax? What do you do?
Well, I do play some tennis.
Okay.
And I read and simply talk to friends and family. For me, after my work, then of course family is first. Mm-hmm. But work takes a lot of our time, so it's work, family, friends, and
tennis.
And tennis.
I'll challenge you to a tennis match when I visit.
Please do. Come ready to sweat.
So, thank you so much, Ambassador Sezibera, for your time. Yeah. Truly honored to have you on One on One.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. There you have it, One on One, featuring the Ambassador Richard Sezibera. He is the Secretary General of the East African Community. And of course, we've had lots of discussions on the issues of integration. More of One on One shows right here on 89.7 Contact FM. Hashtag is 101RW. Let's keep the conversation going on Twitter. Goodbye for now.